So regarding the uses of penicillin G and the repository preparations, you need to keep in mind repository preparations or depot preparations of penicillin is not anything different from penicillin G. It's just penicillin G which is going to act for longer time. So the uses of penicillin G and the depot preparations of penicillins are going to be essentially the same. So let's come to the slide to look at the uses. Streptococcal infections and pneumococcal infections leading to respiratory ENT, that's ear, nose, throat infections, skin and soft tissue infections and meningitis. Then the usual spectrum of penicillin G, that's Cornibacterium diphtheriae, Bacillus anthracis and the Clostridia. So diphtheria, anthrax, gas gangrene, tetanus and listeria. Then gonorrhea and meningitis, that's the neisseria and meningitis due to the H influenzae. And we should not forget syphilis, that's caused by the treponemes. The prophylactic uses of penicillins are extremely important, and we can use penicillins to prevent the post-streptococcal diseases. What we prevent is the infection, the streptococcal infection, and because these illnesses are supposed to be the post-streptococcal illnesses, you can aim at preventing the post-streptococcal illness. This includes rheumatic fever, this includes bacterial endocarditis, and we are preventing it by preventing the streptococcal sore throat. Benzathine penicillin, one injection acts for 1 month, so it's extremely useful for this. Next conditions are syphilis and gonorrhea. You can also use penicillins for prophylaxis of pneumococcal meningitis, H influenzae meningitis, and meningococcal meningitis. And a very important condition is tetanus, which could be prevented with penicillins. Patients having prosthetic heart valves or undergoing procedures, cardiac procedures, or dental or orthopedic procedures, in these patients, you can prevent infections with the use of penicillins. And finally, the patients who suffer from agranulocytosis, who are likely to catch up the infections easily, you can use penicillins to prevent these infections. Penicillin G, repository preparations of penicillin, and penicillin B, all the three are essentially same. They are either penicillin G or the long-acting penicillin G, or is the oral preparation of penicillin G, what we call penicillin B. So all of them, they could be considered as natural penicillins. Penicillin G produced the following adverse effects. Number one is hypersensitivity reaction with an incidence of 1 to 10%. Anaphylaxis, 1 to 4 patients in 10,000 patients. Then superinfection and the Zarish-Herxheimer reaction. These were the important adverse effects. Now we move on to semi-synthetic penicillins. Let's understand what happened. We started using penicillin G. Penicillin G was extremely useful in those days, but it had certain drawbacks. One of the drawbacks was short duration of action. So the scientists came up with the repository or the depot preparations, but this has not changed the antibacterial spectrum or the other characteristics. The penicillin G was also liable to the acid, the gastric hydrochloric acid. So we could not give it by oral route of administration. So it was an important issue to deal with the gastric acid liability of the penicillins. So if we could prepare a penicillin which could be resistant to gastric hydrochloric acid. That was the first aim. The second aim was the narrow spectrum of penicillin G. So if we could widen the spectrum of penicillin G by preparing new compounds, new related compounds, issue number two. And the third issue was the resistance produced by microorganisms by producing beta-lactamase enzyme. So if we could have penicillins which could withstand the beta-lactamase enzyme produced by the penicillins, this would produce by the microorganisms, then this could be extremely useful. So semi-synthetic penicillins were aimed at these three goals: achieving something which will be an acid-resistant penicillin, achieving something which will have extended spectrum, or getting the drugs which will be resistant to the beta-lactamase enzyme produced by the microorganisms. So we classify the semi-synthetic penicillin based on these three things in our mind. Number one is called acid-resistant penicillin, that's penicillin V. These penicillins can be given by oral route of administration because they are resistant to the gastric hydrochloric acid. The second group of semi-synthetic penicillins is extended spectrum penicillin. This is what I was saying, if you could extend the spectrum rather than that limited, narrow, mainly gram-positive spectrum. So we got four types of drugs in this group, extended spectrum penicillins: aminopenicillins, carbenicillins, carbenipenicillins or carboxypenicillins, uridopenicillins and amdenicillins. Four groups of extended spectrum penicillins. And the third one is penicillinase resistant penicillin or beta lactamase resistant penicillin. So the semi-synthetic penicillins have got three groups: acid resistant, extended spectrum, and penicillinase resistant. Penicillinase resistant penicillin example is methicillin and cloxacillin. Let's go on to discuss the semi-synthetic penicillins. Firstly, the acid resistant penicillins. What are they? They are potassium phenoxymethyl or potassium phenoxyethyl and sodium phenoxyethyl or sodium phenoxymethyl. So it's basically penicillin G, but these are the sodium or potassium phenoxyethyl or methyl salts of penicillin G. All of them, they together are called penicillins B. When they came, they were very popular because for the first time you got a penicillin which could be used by oral route of administration. The tablet strength is typical 65 milligrams, 125, 250 and 500 milligrams. And these drugs could be used every 6 hours depending on the patient, depending on the age of the patient and the severity of infection. Indications or uses would be same as penicillin G because it's not different from penicillin G, with the only difference that it is acid resistant. And these drugs are generally preferred for non-serious type of infection. The next one is the extended spectrum penicillins. And the extended spectrum penicillins, we have a chart here. You can have a look at the table. Aminopenicillins, carboxypenicillins, uridopenicillins, and amdinopenicillins or amdinocillins. Aminopenicillins are useful against all the spectrum of penicillin G, but now we are saying they are extended spectrum, so they started working against the gram-negative organisms also. So aminopenicillins have action against gram-negative organisms also. Not too many, but limited number of gram-negative organisms. What are these? This is E. coli, that's Escherichia coli, some proteus organisms, not all proteus, Salmonella, Shigella, H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori, a very important organism, and Listeria. But look at this, the spectrum is widened. So now we started calling this extended spectrum penicillin. Aminopenicillins include ampicillin, amoxicillin, and the esters of ampicillin, that's bacampicillin, talampicillin, and pivampicillin, which are going to be longer acting. The next group, carboxypenicillin, and the group after that, that's uridopenicillin, both of them have been marked on this particular table as anti-pseudomonal penicillins, and you need to remember this fact. Carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins are especially useful against Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and that's why they are called anti-pseudomonal penicillins. Carboxypenicillins examples: carbenicillin, ticarcillin, and hetacillin. And uridopenicillins: piperacillin, azlocillin, and mesalocillin. Piperacillin is a very frequently used uridopenicillin. The last group is amdinopenicillins or amdinocillins. This includes mesylinam and pifmesylinam. So we have four types or four structures of extended spectrum penicillins, four groups: aminopenicillins, carboxypenicillins, uridopenicillins, and amdinopenicillins. Let's start the discussion with the aminopenicillins. That's ampicillin. Look at the dose: 250 to 500 milligrams every 6 hours. Amoxicillin: 250 milligrams every 8 hours. The dose is little small. We'll come to the details later. The esters of ampicillin are bacampicillin, pivampicillin, and talampicillin. And since these are esters, they are going to produce a longer effect. That's 400 to 800 milligrams 2 times a day is the dose for these esters. Look at this particular table. It's showing you all and everything about the aminopenicillins. What's the spectrum? We said extended spectrum. You already said it's the spectrum same as penicillin G. That's your staph, strepto, pneumo, cornibacterium, diphtheri, bacillus anthracis, and clostridium. The 2 gram negative, I hope you won't forget, Neisseria and H. influenzae, and spirochete. That's the same spectrum of penicillin G. In addition, now we come to the gram negative organisms. And they are E. coli, as said earlier, some proteus, H. pylori, Salmonella, Shigella, Listeria, and I'm also adding Brandnamella and Borrelia. So that's the spectrum for aminopenicillins. As far as the uses are concerned, they are extremely useful in one condition, that's peptic ulcer, which is now proven to be due to the H. pylori infection. And in peptic ulcer, you can use it in the dose of 1 gram 2 times a day, along with the other drugs which are used in triple therapy of peptic ulcer. Plus, the other uses include, an important one is Listeria, and ampicillin is drug of choice for Listeria. You can use it for Borrelia brandamella infections, then the enteric fever caused by Salmonella if the organism is sensitive, bacillary dysentery that is caused by Shigella, and urinary tract infection produced by E. coli and some Proteus organisms which are sensitive to ampicillin and amoxicillin. Next important issue to remember is ampicillin and amoxicillin are secreted in bile and they have an enterohepatic circulation. Because of the concentration in the bile, you can think of using these drugs for cholecystitis, the infection in the hepatobiliary tract. Apart from this, down I have written some other conditions which we should not forget. These are mostly the conditions against which penicillin G was also useful. One of them is gonorrhea, and you can use ampicillin 3.5 grams plus probenecid 1 gram as a combination. I would like to remind you of the drug interaction between ampicillin and probenecid. Probenecid is basically a uricosuric agent, but probenecid competes for the renal clearance, renal excretion with the penicillins. So probenecid decreases the renal clearance of penicillins and you get better plasma levels. And this is why this combination is used. The next indication is respiratory infections, ear, nose, throat infections, especially this one, ASOM, that's acute suppurative otitis media. You can use ampicillin or amoxicillin. That's extremely useful. The next condition is meningitis. After this, prevention of post-streptococcal infections, various conditions which we saw with penicillin G. And the final line writes about rest of the spectrum of penicillin G, which is same for ampicillin, amoxicillin. That's diphtheria, tetanus, anthrax, gas gangrene, naseria infections, and spirochetes. So that's the summary of the aminopenicillins. The aminopenicillins, ampicillin and amoxicillin, produce certain important adverse effects. And the first very common adverse effect of ampicillin is diarrhea. As soon as you start consuming ampicillin, you start getting a sensation that there's increased motility in the gastrointestinal tract. This is very common. Between ampicillin and amoxicillin, it's more common with ampicillin. We are going to come to the discussion of why this happens on the subsequent slides. The next common adverse effect of ampicillin and amoxicillin is maculopapular rash or the maculopapular skin eruption. This is extremely common. Whenever you think about ampicillin and amoxicillin, please don't forget these two things, diarrhea and maculopapular rash. The next thing is ampicillin and amoxicillin now have got a little broader spectrum than penicillin G. Naturally, they are going to inhibit many organisms in the gastrointestinal tract, and this is why some other organisms can start multiplying what is called a superinfection. Superinfections can happen with these drugs, and ampicillin is more liable to cause superinfections as compared to amoxicillin. Then the next one is, of course, hypersensitivity reaction. Just because you should not forget, I already mentioned maculopapular rash, but because you should not forget it's a penicillin, that's why I'm adding hypersensitivity reaction. Next, I remind you about that drug interaction, that penicillin should not be mixed in a syringe with aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, or chloramphenicol. So don't mix in a syringe with aminoglycosides, tetracyclines, or chloramphenicol. Indole-positive Proteus, don't think of aminopenicillins. Klebsiella, don't think of aminopenicillins. And Pseudomonas, don't think of aminopenicillins. So when you think of widening the spectrum, first say E. coli, then say some Proteus. And straightway jump to Salmonella, Shigella, Brandamella, Borrelia, Listeria, and H. pylori. Don't bring in the indole-positive Proteus, Klebsiella, and Pseudomonas. Aminopenicillins are not going to be useful against them. Last point to be remembered is aminopenicillins are safer in pregnancy. That's a very important thing. And we've already seen in the pregnancy risk categories, it is much up, that is pregnancy risk category B. And this is where you can think of using penicillins during pregnancy. Now we compare ampicillin and amoxicillin. So you would come to know many answers of the puzzles which were in your mind. Ampicillin has got incomplete oral absorption, whereas amoxicillin absorption is more complete. Ampicillin therefore achieves less plasma levels. Amoxicillin has better plasma levels. Ampicillin has got short half-life. Amoxicillin, the half-life is longer. And this is why with ampicillin, the dose is little more. That's why we say 250 to 500 milligram every 6 hours. So the frequency of administration becomes every 6 hours. Whereas with amoxicillin, the dose is little less. It's not 250 to 500. It's just 250 milligrams. And the frequency of administration becomes every 8 hours, not every 6 hours. So I hope you got the answer for the change in the dose of amoxicillin and why the dose is less and why the frequency of administration is also less. And this is happening because of more complete absorption leading to better plasma levels and longer T-half. Now from this absorption issue, we can derive one more thing. Because with ampicillin, the absorption is incomplete, the drug remains active in the gastrointestinal tract. It can move further in the gastrointestinal tract, and then there is a chance that this active drug, which is not absorbed, will kill some of the microorganisms and some other opportunistic organisms will grow as a superinfection leading to diarrhea. So because the absorption is incomplete, ampicillin is more likely to cause diarrhea as compared to amoxicillin. So that was the difference between ampicillin and amoxicillin. Let's go to the next slide. The various combinations which could be used. Number one, ampicillin could be combined with sulbactam, which is a beta-lactamase inhibitor, and this combination is given by intramuscular or intravenous route of administration. Amoxicillin is combined with clavulanic acid. This is another beta-lactamase inhibitor, but this combination can be used by oral route of administration. We'll throw more light on this issue when we come to the beta-lactamase inhibitors. The next combination, if you remember what we discussed with the penicillins, that they have a synergistic combination with aminoglycosides. So you could combine ampicillin or amoxicillin with gentamicin, amikacin or tobramycin, and you could get the synergistic effect. Once again to remind you, penicillins weaken the cell wall, help the entry of aminoglycosides. Aminoglycosides go in the nucleus and affect the protein synthesis, and because they act by these two different mechanisms, they can help each other. So that's the drug synergism. But important thing one to be remembered once again is don't mix them in a syringe. Don't mix them in an infusion to avoid the inactivation. The next combination I'm reminding you, we already discussed, is ampicillin or amoxicillin combined with probenecid, because probenecid decreases the tubular secretion, decreases the renal clearance of ampicillin and helps for achieving better plasma levels. So that's all about the different combinations you can make with ampicillin or amoxicillin. Let's move forwards. Carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. Please remember, these two agents, these two groups are always used by intramuscular or intravenous route of administration. They are not available by oral route of administration. And as I told you in the beginning, carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins are anti-pseudomonal penicillins. And they are useful against indole positive proteus. They are also useful against anaerobes. So I have written on this slide the spectrum for which we are going to use it. Of course, they inhibit E. coli, proteus, Haemophilus. Important organism added is Pseudomonas as well as Enterobacter. These penicillins, carboxy and uridopenicillins, are called anti-pseudomonal penicillins. So we're going to keep in mind if it's resistant Pseudomonas infection, carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. I have summarized on this slide all the carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. Now please follow the cursor and please follow what I'm saying, then everything will be clear on this slide. Carbamazepine and ticarcillin are the carboxypenicillins. So first we are discussing the carboxypenicillins. And as I said, they are given by intramuscular intravenous route of administration, 1 to 2 grams every 6 hours. Most important thing to remember is carboxypenicillins do not have good penetration in the central nervous system. So I have written less CNS. Although we said they are used intramuscular intravenous, there is one preparation available is carbenicillin in Danil, which can be used by oral route of administration. Now regarding the combinations, ticarcillin can be combined with clavulanic acid, that's a beta-lactamase inhibitor, and carbenicillin as well as ticarcillin can be combined with aminoglycoside. Once again, the synergism between the penicillin and aminoglycoside. Next, we come to the uridopenicillins, and the uridopenicillin, the important one most commonly used is piperacillin, used by intramuscular and intravenous route. And what's the difference between carboxy and urido is carboxy penicillins have got less penetration across CNS, and piperacillin, that's uridopenicillin, penetrates the CNS very well. So it's going to be useful for CNS infections. Similarly, you have the combinations piperacillin with tazobactam, that's another beta-lactamase inhibitor, and once again penicillin aminoglycoside, that's piperacillin and aminoglycoside. Let's come to the indications of carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins seen in the right column. Burns, septicemia, meningitis, post-operative infections, hospital-acquired infections, urinary tract infections, and the infections happening in the immune-compromised host. You can use it for prophylaxis, you can use for treating the infection. If you look at all these conditions, burns, septicemia, meningitis, post-operative and hospital-acquired infections, resistant urinary tract infections, and infections happening in immune-compromised hosts. This will immediately give you a picture what infections we are talking about. We are talking about very serious infections and the organisms which are going to be very fulminant. So obviously we are talking about pseudomonas. Don't forget anti-pseudomonal penicillins are carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. Plus it will include some anaerobic organisms and it will also include indole positive protease. Coming to the next line in the last column, I have written piperacillin is much more effective against pseudomonas as compared to the other drugs. So until now, we slowly progressed from penicillin G, then benzathine penicillin, then penicillin V, then we discussed aminopenicillins, then carboxypenicillins, that carbenipenicillin. So we have come to the best option until now for pseudomonas, that's piperacillin. Secondly, piperacillin can be used in cholecystitis. That's extremely important. And as we said, because uridopenicillins penetrate the CNS, you can use piperacillin for CNS infections. You can use it for meningitis. As far as the adverse effects are concerned, these drugs are going to inhibit too many organisms, and this is why superinfection in the form of diarrhea and colitis is common. Two very different or typical adverse effects are seen with carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. One is precipitating seizures. So you need to take care if the patient is suffering from epilepsy. Secondly, these drugs are known to produce bleeding as well as eosinophilia and hypersensitivity reaction. So mind well, precipitation of seizures and precipitation of bleeding. So patients who are more susceptible to these two conditions, you need to think twice before starting carboxypenicillin or uridopenicillin. And the last reminder once again is don't mix them in a syringe or infusion with aminoglycosides, tetracyclines or chloramphenicol. So that's the discussion about carboxypenicillins and uridopenicillins. Thank you so much. We'll look at the other drugs on the next session.